Hey, Shalom, Rastafari. We're going to continue discussing Exodus. Okay, let's start by mentioning that Exodus is the birth of I and I people, the nation. It's kind of like Abraham being renamed Abraham, meaning a leader of the people. It's a type, and so Moses, he was called Moses because he was drawn out of water, right? And the Egyptian, well, it's thought that in the Egyptian sense of the name, Moses means born out of or son of, like Ramses, Ramoses, or something to that effect, is son of Ra or Re. And so this is important to know because later on, Jah will be like, will mention that he knows I and I by name, and being drawn out of water is going to play into effect. You see, Moses is put into an ark of tall grass in a march, which is this month. Exodus has, I mean, March has been the study of the Sabbath studies of Exodus, right? And Ethiopia on the march. Well, anyways, that's just extra right there. And so, I and thy people have been drawn out of water, out of trouble. Because, you see, you could see this similarity play out throughout all of Scripture. The angel goes and tells Joseph, hey, get your people out of here because they're trying to kill them. And same story. And so, basically, what it's trying, metaphysically, I guess, what it's trying to describe here is how when we're in the deepest of troubles, that's when we get saved, we get redeemed, because that's the moment where we find the presence of Jah within I and I. Because when there's not, when it's the darkest of times and there's nothing to hold on to, you hold on to yourself, there's nothing to grab onto, so you hold on tight. Those that are wise, and you end up holding on to Jah, we end up being saved in eagle's wings, because apparently we're holding on to nothing, but in reality we're holding on to everything, which is within I and I, which is, that's why I did that one song for the Psalm 114, because it says, it's saying something to the effect of, why thou Jordan, that why did thou fleddest the back, and then it says, and thy sea, what ailed thee to move back, turn back? It's the presence, which is also described in Exodus chapter 33, where it's, let me find that. It's verse chapter 33, Exodus. Verse 14, it says, and he said, my presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest. And so, what is the Jordan River, which means descending, but then it stands in the presence of Jah, and it turns back. It's funny because the word for overthrow or turn back or something, in the Blue Letter Bible, it's hafak, and I just thought it was funny. Yeah, I guess I'm still a baby and I'm still immature, but it's kind of humorous how it's hafak, the Hebrew hafak, to turn back. And well, it's like, oh fuck, well, excuse my language. Well, anyways, that wasn't even necessary. I apologize. And so, I went totally off track. Let's go back to the conception of Moses. Okay, so he's presented as if he's the firstborn, but later on, people find this to be a contradiction, because later on we find out that Aaron is older, and his older sister. But you gotta understand that he's the firstborn of the goodly child. Let's go to Exodus verse I mean, Exodus chapter 2, verse 1. And it says, I mean, verse 2, and it says, and the woman conceived and bare a son. And when he saw the son, that he was a goodly child. You see this pattern, like, being played out throughout scripture. She hid him 3 months. Now, I guess, share my idea, which is what I accept as truth, is that you find this throughout scripture. The goodly child is hidden from danger until it's time. I see this being played out as Ethiopia, you know, Jah being the wisest, you know, his wisdom being far exceeding that of man, not even close. Well, a lot of stuff was to happen, and so Jah being as the wise that he is, he hid, I guess, the royal bloodline, or the branch. That there's something about that tree, which the Nazarene, there's this word similar to that that means it's it describes a tree that it could. The root could be, I guess, one part of the tree could be growing in one place, and then all of a sudden, there's another root sprouting, like, somewhere completely unexpected, like, not related to the original tree, but they're still linked. And so this is kind of like a branching out of Jah. He branched out into Ethiopia, and he hid the ark, you know, he hid, well, I guess I don't have the word to describe it. I apologize for that. But basically, he hid the child, the son of man, in a place where he knew that he was going to be protected by the natural barriers of the land, so that just around when the beast, I guess, would be sufficiently up, I guess, would be advanced enough to the point where the beast would be able to penetrate that natural barrier that protected the Son of Man, it would be just around that time that the Son of Man was to be born. Kind of like in Revelations where Michael's angels, there's a war in heaven before, and dang, I went completely off track, but let's continue. Okay, so Revelation, there's this war before I guess it describes, I think it's chapter 11 something. Okay, let's finish this really quick. And so they win. Michael and his angels win, and I see that as the Battle of Menu, like how they defeated Italy, but then Italy comes back again, and they make war with the angels once more, and this time, you know, things are different, but they're for a reason. Well, let's go back to Exodus. I'm sorry about that. And so I apologize. I'm going all over the place, but hey, Let's continue. So he was being, so Moses is hid 3 months, right? And then Deuteronomy 34, verses 4, I say that because it's where it's stated that Moses will not enter the promised land. It's not so much that he's not going to enter, but this is, Moses is a sign of the times, and this is an example of how our God and Father, he's so loving that he gives us free will, and he's not going to force us, or he's not going to be like, oh yeah, those that I picked for sure are going to make it, you know, and gives us the opportunity to be messing around because, you know, to become spoiled because we're automatically accepted. No, this chapter 34 in Deuteronomy verse 4 indicates that it's not a sure thing, you know, like Wario Paulo's, how he mentions that to make our election sure. Correct me if it was even him that said that, but principle of the matter is the same, that to secure our election, you know, it's not for sure. So Moses represents that, how Moses represents the future, guiding us through that burning bush, that star. And if we're wise men and women, we'll go after that sign, or we'll discern the sign of the times, and we'll get to see the character of the times, which is His Imperial Majesty at this time, and we'll be able to disclose Jah and know what's going on, and then hopefully, you know, like, walk into the promised land. And so it's important to understand that it's not a sure thing, you know. We can make it a sure thing, I guess, by living the rest of our lives, you know, working as hard as possible to obtaining that goal, that promise, our inheritance, which is, now that it reminds me, it's the main reason of this teaching, or sharing, discussion, you know. And we'll go into that a little further. And so Moses stumbles across the burning bush. He's not looking for it. He just happens to bump into something. Hey, you know, this bright light, and he comes to realize, hey, you know, there's something about that light. And then he realizes that this light don't need no support. This light it's light illuminating all of its own. He realizes this is holy ground. This is the real deal. You know, this is some real stuff. Just like I personally experienced. I was not looking for no divine guidance, and you know, I rejected all that Jesus Christ philosophy since I was really young. I swore allegiance to wrong or to evil, you know. But I guess I found out in time that it wasn't that I wanted to be like satanic or anything like that. I was just completely against that false Christianity, which is what I came to understand. Because, you know, even through I mistakes, never evil to where, like, pure evil, you know? It's just like just lost, you know, no guidance without a father, you know, like in tough circumstances. But, you know, now that I bring that up, I'm gonna just go right into it. I and I are like different people. We're a mixed multitude. We got nothing in common. We don't even have a culture. We got nothing, you know. And so historians, they can't figure out how, like, in a span of 200 years, you know, Moses gathered up all these people into one common, like, one common goal. And so, like, they can't explain it, but I'll discern it right now. It's not rules and regulations such as religions that's going to make this. It's Jah manipulating history and time and nature, which is also symbolic of the crossing the sea, you know, parting the waters. It's Jah's going to do what he got to do, you know, so that he can form us. So that, you see, in His Imperial Majesty biography, Life and Progress of Ethiopia, he's always mentioning how life, you know, ups and downs, you're happy, then you're sad, you're happy, then you're sad. He's describing the sea and the sea saw and fled, you know, at the presence of Jah. Well, saw, you could go into saw, break that down. It's sar, to cesar, or to cesaria, which is like a cut, and to stone. In some places, rock is translated as from sar or sur to rock, and we are that rock, and Jah is the mason, you know, and he's trying to form something out of us, if I and I so will. But let's not be stiff-necked, I guess, stiff-necked people, something to that effect. Let me find that. You see, because I'll just mention, as I find that scripture, it says, the thing about having a stiff neck is that if we turn back, we're going to break our necks because we're on the cross. You know what I'm saying? And so, what was one of the fulfillments of Jesus? That not a single bone was broken. And so we can't be stiff-necked, you know? We can't harden our hearts. We gotta be soft and be, let ourselves be shaped. And then Jai is gonna use history and nature, and that's what I and I all share in common. I and I are united and in, because we have a common history and a common experience upon this earth here. And that will link I and I. That will be like, we don't even have to know each other because we've been through the same stuff, you know? Sure, some stories are you know, a little more tough than others. But the basic idea is that if we ever get together and talk, we're probably going to just be like, if we knew each other, like, forever. Because that it was meant that way, purposely. And so, which is why I did that one Psalm 114 and did like a little singing. I'm not trying to be an artist. I'm not trying to be a musician. I don't even care about those things. What I'm trying to do is kind of, I'm actually shy, but for His Majesty, you know, for Rastafari, man, I'll do what needs to be done. And that's what I want to stress upon I and I. We've been chosen, you know. You know, chapter 33 in Exodus, Jah says, you know, I'll show grace to whomever I feel like showing grace. Jah has shown grace to I and I. That's deep right there. If you really stop and think about it, and I'm not saying this because I've perfected to be in that state of mind all the time. I'll forget 10 seconds from now that out of all the people in the world, because people, I mean, brethren and sisters, understand, Jai is who he is. Out of all the people in the world, it's I and I that have been chosen. That's deep. That's on. It's hard to, I accept it, I understand it, but do I, am I really there? You know, it's not something I would want to, I guess, confirm myself. It's something so big, it's something so out of, it's unexplainable. I guess our actions have to record truth. And well, back to Exodus. Jah being the main actor of human experiences, he switches things up and he places a scenario here and another scene over there so that I and I can bond and have a common experience. And it's not because I and I is eloquent like Moses. See, he didn't choose him because of the things that he could do. Rather, because the things Moses lacked would serve useful for Jah. And so, back to the main topic. I want to stress upon all the eyes that to be patient. Once again, 10 minutes from now, I'm going to grow impatient, but right now I'm saying it, you know. It's hard to be Rastafari. We don't have a tabernacle. Nothing seems like anything is coming together. But it is, because that which we lack is exactly what is useful for Jah. You see, Jah's wisdom is beyond comprehension. Let's just go with it and faith. You know, trust in Jah that everything will play out, because it will. It's just that we got to end it knowing that that Jah will be done. If we give up, well, it's like turning back. We break our necks. And you know, a stiff-necked person cannot go up on a cross. You know, thou shalt not break any of the bones of the lamb on the Passover, you know. Well, let's go back. Let's go back to the actual, man, I went off track. All kinds. Okay, so the burning bush. Moses, he's confronted by a new knowledge of God, a true knowledge of God. And so he's turned into a man of destiny, which is what I and I is to become. And he ends up serving the will of Jah under Jah election to serve at a certain moment of time. This is reflective of the tabernacle of the congregation. It's kind of the tabernacle of the meeting place. It's a meeting at a certain point in time. It's not then or now. It's eternal. It's like, I'm going to call you when I'm going to call you. You know, that's Jah, like, basically that's what he's saying. And so it fits into us not having a tabernacle. You see, when Israel started worshiping the calf, and then Moses said, you know, who's with me? And they took off, and then the next orders of Jah was that every man make a tabernacle outside of the camp, not within the camp. The camp is already corrupted. So let's not worry about having a camp. I don't think we should even be thinking about building one before we even build ourselves, because we've learned that the camp is corruptible, like ASAP. And so that which we lack is what is of use to Jah. So let's, brothers and sisters, let's not get down on these issues. It's hard, I understand. There's, you know, it's like there's no direction. But to the director, you know, it's his direction. I guess that's kind of confusing, but kind of like, think about a movie. You don't have to, you're an actor, you don't even have to know what the movie's about. It's the director, because he's got everything planned out. I mean, he's going to pull some moves at the end. He's going to, you know, bust out with his hidden tricks or whatever to make that movie what nobody expected it to be. So let's continue. Let's stay strong. And so give me just 1 second. I got notes all over the place, man. Okay, let's just go to, so Moses creates a community, and it's led, oh, Moses, he leads I and I in and out of a common experience. Yeah, I guess this will better explain what I said earlier. You see, we go into the wilderness and we go through troubles, we go through life, basically. And the endurance of that, you know, enduring through the wilderness and the temptations and all of that will result in that common experience, you know, that I and I share in common because of similar historical experiences that we're going to share. And because we endured, we're going to learn, like, all the social necessities, like economics and I don't even have more examples, like legal and social order and culture, that we're gonna gain through enduring the time at the wilderness. It's a unique historical experience. We're so blessed to be a part of it, you know. So, once again, crossing of the sea is Jah's manipulation of history and nature to his ultimate purpose. Isaiah. Okay, let's go to. Well, let me just throw in there now that we're there. The tables. The first table of given to Moses, I guess it would represent like our birth. Like the law was supposed to be in our heart, but we broke that like real quick, you know? And so these new tables I see as representing Jesus Christos and his Imperial Majesty Kedamawi Haile Selassie. Because like the two witnesses. Let me go to Exodus 33, and I'm sure. Let me see if I can find it, but there's this verse. The words that were in the first tables, which thou breakest, and ready morning and coming to Sinai. Okay, I don't even have to. Well, I do, but I don't want to take more time. I'm gonna just play it out by remembrance. I shouldn't do this, but I apologize. So, what's in the tables, the commandments? What does Jesus say? You know, do the command and follow the commandments, because that's what my father commanded I. And what does His Imperial Majesty Haile Selassie say? Advice to the now generation. What did he advise everyone? Follow the Ten Commandments. You know, you've read them, you know them, and you can. What is it that he says? You can expound on them or something to that effect. I apologize. So these tables I see as the two witnesses, and it's important because all over Exodus we're that rock. And what are the tables constructed of rock? And so those pillars, those eternal pillars, you know, like an everlasting pillar, Tuja, a memorial. And so I guess let's go to Isaiah 53, chapter 53, verse 1. Okay, no, my bad. Isaiah chapter 51, verse 1. I apologize. Once again, I'm not a professor or anything. You know, bear with me. Sorry. So it says here, hearken to me, ye that follow after righteousness, ye that seek the Lord. Look to the rock whence ye are hewn. Hewn rocks. Well, let us continue. And to the hole of the pit whence ye are digged. Are we not digged out of this mess? You know, like when I is in trouble. Because that's when I found out, when I was rock bottom, they say, right? Okay, let us not even go into explaining that. Pretty much self-explanatory. Look to Abraham your father and to Sarah that bare you. I called him alone and blessed him and increased him. For the Lord shall comfort Zion. He will comfort all her waste places, and he will make her wilderness like Eden and her deserts like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness shall be found therein, thanksgiving and the voice of melody. Hearken to me, my people, and give ear to me, O my nation, for a law shall proceed from me, and I will make my judgment to rest for a light of the people. My righteousness is near, my salvation has gone forth, and mine arm shall judge the people. The isles shall wait upon me, and on my arm shall they trust. Check this out, this is pretty. If we are to be separated holy to the Lord, like when John is in the captivity in the island of Patmos in Revelation, and Jamaica being bearing witness to his majesty, those isles are bodies separated from the land. That's interesting right there. And so I lost my place, but let us continue. And the arm, you know, the arm. Remember I said something about holding on to yourself and then finding Jah, and then you're holding on to Jah, and he's, and we're carried off on eagle's wings. Oh, that has to do with that. And so lift up your eyes to heaven. Before I continue, this is when it's saying, you know, hear and listen. And I accept it to be Jah trying to be like, let me, you know, work with me. Like, let me do my thing. Let me shape you. Let me mold you. Let me, like the potter, working his, you know, doing this thing. Like sometimes when I draw, sometimes I can't draw for nothing. And then, you know, if the drawing had life, I'd be telling it, listen, man, I have a really good picture, you know. If you only hearken to me and you know, hear me out and are willing and you cooperate, then you know, you'll end up at a high ranking museum, you know, like top exhibition. Well, anyways, that's just kind of like an example. Once again, I lost my place. And look upon the earth beneath. For the heavens shall vanish away like smoke, and the earth shall wax old like a garment, and they shall dwell therein. They that dwell therein shall die in like manner. But my salvation shall be forever, and my righteousness shall not be abolished. Hearken to me, ye that know righteousness, the people in whose hearts is my law. Fear ye not the reproach of men, neither be ye afraid of their revilings or something. For the moth shall eat them up like a garment, and the worm shall eat them like wool, but my righteousness shall be forever, and my salvation from generation to generation. That worm and the moth, it's, I'm not going to go into it right now, but it's representative. It's like a foreshadowing of Jonah. And so let's continue. Awake. Awake. Put on strength. Strength once again. O arm of the Lord, awake as in the ancient days, in the generations of old. Art thou not in that hath cut Rahab and wounded the dragon? Art thou not it which hath dried the sea, the waters of the great deep, that hath made the depths of the sea a way for the ransomed to pass over? This is really important. It's that point. It's like when you're in that deep hole in those deep waters, either you get it or you don't. You know, you could be saved by manly things and, you know, get back up or whatever and nothing happened. Or you could really look into thyself and be like, damn, what the, you know? I remember I used to be lost, man. I'd be like, I didn't even know what I wanted, but I didn't want this, you know? And I would say that openly. I was like, I would tell people, I'm tired of this, you know? And it's that redeeming process. I hope I'm not saying too much. I hope I'm not saying too much than I should, but it's for a good cause. When you're in trouble, man, it's when you can hold on to something true, something real, and so it's that turning point, you know, that crossing over once again. And so that's why I wanted to throw in this scripture. It's important for us. So now let us, yeah, I guess we could go to Isaiah chapter 53 now. You know what? I'm so sorry again. It's chapter 43. Like I said, I got notes all over the place. I'm just trying to get some Jah study going on here. Okay, here we go. But now, thus saith the Lord, that created thee, O Jacob, and he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee. I have called thee by thy name. Thou art mine. Once again, it's the same thing going on here. O Israel, I created thee. O Jacob, I formed thee. It's that cutting of rock. It's that masonry. It's that seesaw. Once the wave offering, you could even say. I think it plays out in similarity to the wave offering. And, positive vibrations, high frequency vibrational, vibrations, I'm sorry, or low frequency. You can even relate it to how someone is in a hospital. What do you want that little machine to be like? Beep, beep, beep. You want to get enough beeps in there, because if it starts slowing down to a slower vibration and a lower frequency, what does that mean? You're about to die. Basically, that seesaw, you want to keep that sea balance and flowing, Oh, I just want to mention, Caesarea and SAR, and that's all connected. It's cutting. But in Spanish, we say, for if you want to go hunting, you say cacería, right? But then, if, like a warning shout, like a blow of the trumpet, whenever, you're crossing the street and there's a crazy car just, hauling, really fast, and I guess the blow of the trumpet, the blow of the shofar in Spanish is they yell out waters, but they say agua, aguas, como, watch out. And so it's a forewarning of dangers, like watch out, man, waters, I guess you could say, aguas. Yeah, just throwing that in there. And so, when thou pass it through the waters, I will be with thee. Once again, my presence shall be with thee. Exodus chapter 33. Once again, it says here, when thou pass it through the waters, I will be with thee. And through the rivers, once again, Jordan fleeing back. They shall not overflow thee. Once again, His Imperial Majesty, he clearly says, when they were in this lake, and his discretion is to be noted, he says that it was an accident, right? And he was saved because he knew how to swim. But there was like 13 others that did not make it. And he names each one of them in a memorial. And there's also a coincidence that there's this French doctor or something like on a expedition and happens to help out once, because when he made it ashore, barely made it, his Imperial Majesty says that the waters, the dangers almost went up to his soul. And it's funny now that I mentioned that, it's kind of where I got lost last time. That lake has dried up. It's no longer a lake. It was a big lake, and it's dry. And so, just a moment ago, in Isaiah chapter 51, it said something to that effect, that, who drieth the seas? Which is what I was trying to get into last time, but I guess it wasn't time for that. Now that I speak of time, brothers and sisters, don't try to rush things. We got to work within job time. If things don't play out the way I and I wish they would, it's because it's not Jah time. The space and time is not aligned to Jah, or better yet, Jah is not aligned space and time to that, for that to be. Let us not try to do anything out of Jah time. It's very important that we get that, because if we do, we're gonna just mess it up. Jah wisdom is greater than all man put together. He trying to know what he do, you know. And he's lining up something good if we only wait for it. So let's not get, you know, too excited or down because something didn't happen. Well, now, well, let me just mention that when he declares his name in chapter 3, verse 14, Exodus, he's basically telling Moses, look, before they used to call upon the name of the Lord, they used to call El Shaddai, and then, I'm sorry, I can't even recall other names, but for every instance, for every distinct situation, they had a name, a specific name for the Lord that would come and help at that moment regarding that situation. But in Exodus chapter 3, verse 14, in the pie in the radius, he says, look, I'm going to be that which I need to be. I am that which I am. I is what is. He's saying, now I'm gonna be in this, you know. I'm gonna be with you now. Like, and like, you don't have to call me like by different names or whatever, because I'm gonna be what I need to be what be in that time. You know, I'm gonna be whatever character I need to be. I'm gonna do what I gotta do. I'm gonna move what I gotta move. It's basically what he's stating, that he's gonna participate from then on in every aspect of I and I. You know, and he tells us, you know, grab that serpent by the tail, you know, I'm going to get bit. But no, like, you know, he's, from now on, I'm going to be there, you know, and that serpent turns into a rod. Jah be there, you know, because you be where you need to be. And I guess that's one of the main differences of that name of the Yod Hey Wow Hey, the Yahweh, you know, Tetragrammaton or whatever, you know, it's the significance behind that. It's when he declares, I'm gonna be like involved, you know, I've heard your cry, like, now I'm gonna be there, like I'm not gonna wait for you to call, I'm, you know, now that I think about it, it's like he's trying to tell us, like, man, don't even trip. I'm going to be making moves for you. You know, just stay aligned. You know, stay true. And so, once again, I went off track. So let I continue. When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned. Neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. Thou shalt not be burned. Doesn't say we're not going to be melted, you know. But Jesus Christ wants gold tried by fire, right? So these troubles are going to try I and I. And if I and I is gold worthy, I and I going to make it through that trouble. And then, I guess the Ethiopic word for to be melted, dissolved, which is, I guess, a part of the potter's job. I guess first he's got to mold us and melt us and then make us into a substance, you know, bendable, flexible, willing to change, you know, that will to conform to the will of the Most High God, Jah, Rastafari, is Mechwe, if I'm saying it correct. And then water would be Made. I forgot how this ties in into the Yod, but, so I guess I'm not going to. Oh yeah, sur or sar, it's cut, form, shut, confine, to press, to urge. to bind, to besiege, to cramp, to secure. Well, it's like I'm on a roll today, like going off track. So, for I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior. I gave Egypt for thy ransom, and Ethiopia and Seba for thee. For I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior. I gave Egypt for thy ransom. Oh, my bad. Since thou wast precious in my sight, thou hast been honorable, and I have loved thee. Therefore will I give men for thee and people for thy life. Fear not, for I am with thee. I will bring thy seed from the east, and gather thee from the west. I will say to the north, give up, and to the south, keep not back. Bring my sons from far, and my daughters from the ends of the earth. You know, I'm remembering that you know, I keep in touch with Wyndham Yadon and all the teachings, and just earlier, you want to think that the Bible is sexist? Whatever, it clearly says. My sons and my daughters. You know, for all the sistering. Even everyone that is called by my name, Rastafari. For I have created him for my glory. I have formed him. Yea, I have made him. Bring forth the blind people that have eyes, and the deaf that have ears. Kind of like that, the cross. Cross, eyes of the blind, ears of the deaf, you know, everything, salvation of the afflicted. Let all the nations be gathered together, and let the people be assembled. Who among them can declare this? And show us former things. Let them bring forth their witness, that they may be justified. Or let them hear and say, it is true. You know, no one really has a living God, if you think about it. No one can. No one, you know, they can laugh or, you know, say whatever they want, but nobody can say these things except for I and I. Which is food for thought. You know, I know a bunch of people, not a whole lot, you know, but those that have accepted Rastafari, you know, they don't go forward. They say that he is who he is, but they don't want to accept the responsibility. I think that's pretty, how can ones... You know, it shows how we're so special to Jah. Because I've had people be like, straight up, what you speak is true. He is who he is. But they don't wish to follow. It's just... I guess it's surprising to me, because I've heard some, you know, some true witness. But not backed up by any, you know, by any proceeding of seeking that. I don't know. I guess I said that because it's pretty, it kind of ties into what I just read. But that's how naive people are willing to be. Like, yeah, that's true. He's who he is. But then, like, just completely not care. So, ye are my witnesses, said the Lord, and my servant, whom I have chosen, once again, elect Rastafari, that ye may know and believe me, and understand that I am he. Before me there was no God formed, neither shall there be after me. I, even die, or I and I, am the Lord, and beside me there is no Savior. I have declared, and I have saved, and I have showed. When there was no strange God among you, like I said earlier, therefore ye are my witnesses, saith the Lord, that I am God. Yea, before the day, I am He. And there is none that can deliver out of my hand. I will work, and who shall let it? Oh, okay. So right here, it's like, who is gonna let me do my thing and turn you into a beautiful creation of God? Basically, that's what I guess that's kind of what I understand. Thus said the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, for your sake I have sent to Babylon and have brought down all their nobles and the Chaldeans whose cry is in the ships. I am the Lord your Holy One, the Creator of Israel, your King. Thus said the Lord, which make it a way in the sea and in a path in the mighty waters. So, He creates tribulation for I and I, because we're foolish. And only wise-hearted men and women that seek truth, that's our ransom. That's our turning point, our crossover, that, you know, rock bottom. So we can be, you know, we're at the bottom of the hill, and we're to be human, we're to be, you know, carved out and molded, and, you know. Well, it's important. Let's go back to when it said, I have given Egypt, Ethiopia, and Seba for thy ransom. Thou was precious in my sight. Thou was honorable. I have loved thee. Therefore I will give men for thee and people for thy life. This ain't a joke. I and I can bear witness to the Most High has given Ethiopia, Egypt, and Seba for our ransom. Once again, I lost that connection to the importance of our election. It, like, I wasn't kidding. It's hard to completely, you know, only Joshua stayed in the tabernacle, if you recall Exodus chapter 33. Moses was in and out. The other Levites were in and out, but Joshua stayed in the tabernacle. A lot of lives have been lost. Basically, I understand that everyone's kind of like a sacrifice to allow I and I to be that which Jah want I and I to be. And so we can't take that for granted. There's too much. It wouldn't be fair to all those lost lives. We gotta step it up. We gotta do what we gotta do. Cause I have given Seba, Ethiopia, and Egypt for thy ransom. Like saying, I've done what I've done to these lands and peoples for you. The cost of our ransom has been murder, blood, and sacrifice to the fullest extent of the word or term sacrifice. It's now that I'm thinking about it, wow, you know? It's hard to even like discuss. It's important that we step it up. We I can't recall at this point, but His Majesty, he refers to saying that, I think it's in that little booklet, The Wise Mind of His Imperial Majesty, where he states something to the effect of it's the bloodshed of in that case, I think it was referring to like soldiers that had fought for Ethiopia. His Majesty says that if I and I don't do what we have to do, it's like they died in vain. But it's our responsibility to continue forward, because if not, those lives would have been spent vainly. So with that being said, let us just go to chapter 33, Exodus, because I wanted to mention how there's this up and down dilemma between Moses and Jah, where Moses is like, I didn't, it's those people that Jah tells Moses, you and that people that you brought up, and then Moses will be like, no, well, those people that you gave me, and they'll be like, well, these people are complaining, and then in Jah in his grace, he sends down manna, and then like, and so this constant up and down between Moses and Jah, and I see it as it's the configuration of grace. It's grace building up. The law is there, but they're still not saved. Moses, he says that if I have found grace in thy sight, why haven't you told me who you're gonna send? Like Christ, like Jesus, he's like, those that I receive are sent of my Father, or something to that effect. It's that grace being played out. Jesus already knew, but Moses, because when the Israelites started worshiping the calf, Moses was like, you said you know I ain't died by name, but obviously those aren't the ones, so who are the ones, And then they're working out that grace, and once again the teaching of Wyndham Yadon Ras Ayadanis, it just came to mind where he's saying that His Majesty, next time send the right people. His Majesty is sounding a lot like Moses right now. I was like, who's with me? Like, and then he goes and argues with Jah, like, if I have found favor in thy sight, and they start, let us go to, now that I got into that, let's go to Exodus chapter 33. It's a must now. I was gonna go to Psalm 114, but we'll hold that up. And this is outside of the tabernacle. So once again, brothers and sisters, let's not get down because we don't got a church. We know churches are corrupted. We know let's not go that way. And the Lord spoke to Moses face to face. This is verse 11, chapter 33. Kind of like the ark, face to face, the angels speaking face to face. Like a man speaketh to his friend. Once again, Jesus, New Testament, he declares that to not to see him as a master, rather as a friend, because the master doesn't tell his laborers his plans, and Jesus did. So, and then, and he turned again into the camp. You see, he's going in and out. But his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, departed not out of the tabernacle. Once again, a foreshadowing. And Moses said to the Lord, see, thou sayest to me, bring up this people, and thou hast not let me know whom wilt, oh, I'm sorry, let me try that again. And Moses said to the Lord, see, thou hast sent to me bring. Dang. Let me try it again. And Moses said to the Lord, see, thou sayest to me, bring up this people, and thou hast not let me know whom thou wilt send with me. See, once again, that little, that discussion, like, he's kind of frustrated, like, okay, you told me you were going to, you know, send some people, but then now I don't know what people it is, because it's obviously not these people, because these people are doing this, you know, are worshiping this little calf or whatever. So I guess it's showing some kind of frustration here on the side of Moses. And continuing, it says, yet thou hast said, I know thee by name, and thou hast also found grace in my sight. So he's telling Jah, but you said that you know that by name, and that you found grace in my sight. Well, he's going to continue, and he's going to say, like, let me find grace in thy sight, you know. And now therefore I pray thee, if I have found grace in thy sight, show me now thy way. I guess he's asking for yeses, that I may, that doesn't go with the scripture, but that I may know thee, that I may find grace in thy sight, and consider that this nation is thy people. So he wants to know, like, what people, you know, am I going to take? Show me thy way. Show me Jesus, basically, he's saying, I guess. And he said, my presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest. And he said, I guess this is Moses, if thy presence go not with me, carry us not up hence. Like, if you're not going to be there, I don't want to go up there. For wherein shall it be known here that I and thy people have found grace in thy sight? Is it not in that thou goest with us? So shall we be separated, like the islands, I and thy people, from all the people that are upon the face of the earth? And the Lord said to Moses, I will do this thing. Here's that grace playing out. Also that thou hast spoken, for thou hast found grace in my sight. And I know thee by name. And he said, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. And he said, thou cannot see my face, for there shall no man see me and live. And the Lord said, behold, there is a place by me, and thou shalt stand upon a rock. Okay, before I go off track, I guess Jah finds grace when one is like, when one really wants it. You can see Moses is like, okay, man, like, please let me know. He's practically begging. And but that's good, because there is no shame in truth, right? And wanting to know truth. And so, show me thy glory. It's interesting for me to go into this, because that, those verses where it says that no man shall see me and live, that might be confusing, but if it's kind of tricky, I guess, because it has to do with, okay, if Jah is before us, then he's in front of us, and we're going to be seeing his back, and we can't turn back, we can't be stiff-necked and go the other way. As well as if we see his face, that means we're going against him. So this is not that see, like, no one's ever gonna see Jah. It's more like when Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. You know, for there is only one God, one true God. It's like, if brothers and sisters, don't want to see Jah face, because that means you're going against him, you know? Basically, let's end it at that. And it's important, oh, last thing, because we've gone, it's been like an hour now, and I'm sure you guys got things to do. There we go again, guys. I apologize, brothers and sisters. You brothers and sisters probably have things to do. Now, the last thing I'm going to mention, 40 days, 40 nights. Right here is a foreshadowing and a type of the Mount of Configuration. It's not in this chapter. I think it's in chapter 34. But this conversation being held up in the Mount, Moses wants to know thy way. So what is Jah going to show him? Jesus. And it's in that mountain. And it's in that very moment. Another thing, I think this is where Moses wrote the whole everything. Because Moses was not going to take 40 days and 40 nights to write the Decalogue, you know? A lot of people, he didn't stay up there that long to write the Decalogue. This is where he got all his information, you know what I'm saying? From the five books. It's got to be. So, well, let me go again. I guess, continue. Basically, we're in it, so. So Moses goes up with two tables, with two witnesses, right? So it sounds a lot like the Mount of Configuration. I wasn't even thinking about this. But he goes up there with two tables. And the Lord descended in the cloud. And with him there, and proclaimed the name of the Lord. Remember? When Peter and them, like, they say something. Oh, when Peter says, oh, let's make three churches or three buildings, three tabernacles. Or there's a thunder. There's a voice from heaven. This is my son in whom I am well pleased. This is where it says here, verse 5, chapter 34. And he descended on the cloud with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth. There's two different scriptures in the New Testament. One, Jesus says, in one, Jesus looks up, and I think Jesus proclaims the name of the Lord, and then in another, the Lord, kind of like there's a back and forth, and I can't recall the script, so let's not even go there, but surely this plays out in the New Testament, like word to word, like I'm not even kidding, this is deep. Let me just end by, when Moses comes down from the mountain, but when Moses, my bad, and when Aaron and all the children of Israel saw Moses, behold, look and see, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come nigh him. That's when he starts putting on the veil, except before Jah. I went into the Blue Letter Bible, and the search thing on the internet, and shown. It actually means like. Good thing I'm on. Hold on. I gotta find it. It means like, I don't wanna mess this up. I'm gonna just hold on 1 second. Karan or Karan is the Hebraic. Karan. Karan or Karin. To radiate, to emit beams, to shine. So basically, it's like when it's the mountain of configuration, you know, it's the same thing that happened to Jesus, that his face configured. So, you know, we've gone a long ways. I went all over the place for that. I apologize. I thought I had something prepared. I guess, you know, I have other plans. That's okay. And actually, that's better. Brothers and sisters,